Hello and welcome to the first ever sports podcast with me, Arush. And today we have with us two very special guests and also my two best friends, Parth Dave and Vaibhav Ajmera.
Hello, Arush.
Welcome, guys. Welcome.
Hello. What's up, brother?
So this is basically, as you can guess, it's going to be a very fun little discussion about all the major sporting events going on in the world right now. So what better place to start with than the EPL? What the hell is going on this year, Parth?
Yeah, this has been a trademark EPL season where you've had a breakthrough team who has performed against the odds. The only difference this time has been that the team has been able to maintain that run for over a sustained period, which is why people have started taking them as genuine title contenders. As for the other teams, I think this is a golden chance for a club like Arsenal to get a win under the belt. Like, it's been a long time since they've won a league, so this is their best chance. And City are always strong contenders. I think United have gone back a little, but they're still in it if the numbers are considered. But more or less, a very refreshing season.
Also, the form of Jamie Vardy for Leicester has been absolutely brilliant. Did you expect him to do this well this year, considering that last year he wasn't really their main man? Vaibhav, you can answer this question.
See, last year we weren't following the team as much, but still about Jamie Vardy, we've been listening from a long time that he's been that lone striker getting them from the roots. However, he's played, or the supporting guy, whoever is playing with him. Sometimes it is Mahrez, sometimes it's someone out of the blue. So they are performing well, but their sustainability at that level has been a great achievement. I think this is what they wanted to achieve, like threaten for the longest period and maybe get a chance at the title. But I don't think so they are reaching there. I'm not saying that they've achieved less, but whatever it is, there are deserving teams who will go beyond them. But that doesn't mean that they won't come back strong next year. They might just come back strong next year. So it's a constant threat. And also the other teams like that, the smaller teams, who are using this as a leverage point, trying to hit the weaker sections of the team, which Leicester has found out, and they have started looking at it more. So that will be another threat for the teams next year. So a bigger challenge in EPL awaits next season, because Manchester United is also, or might just get a new manager. Chelsea will definitely have a new manager. Liverpool, Klopp is already there as an exciting person to watch. So against the odds, against the smalls, it's going to be an exciting battle next year. This is what I predict according to the Leicester situation right now. This is what they're doing to EPL in next year. So it's much bigger than what they're doing to EPL this year.
But do you guys believe that they can finish in the top four this year?
See, that I'm saying I'm not predicting anything. Anything can happen. Whatever they have achieved is good enough for them. I would hope that they finish in the top four. They deserve that much. They deserve that much credit. They might just finish in the top three. That's what I predict.
What do you feel, Parth?
I think I'll agree with Weber on the first half of his statement that I think they'll be genuine top four contenders. Top three would be a little tough, but I wouldn't be surprised if they finish top three.
And your team, by the way, both Parth and Vaibhav are Arsenal supporters. Vaibhav has just turned into an Arsenal supporter. He used to be a United supporter like me, but he betrayed us and now he has shifted his allegiance towards Arsenal. And so they're pretty pleased this year because Arsenal are doing well. They're third right now, but it's just, I mean, what's it on GD? And yeah, it's on GD. And they've looked strong. They've looked very consistent. Could this be the year? Could this finally be the year you break the jinx and win the EPL?
That's a very common thing that is always associated with an Arsenal fan or a Liverpool fan in the last few years. That could this be the year? Could this be the year? So at this moment, I don't think the team is thinking about the league right now. I think they are planning to, you know, go through, break down the season into parts and, you know, go game by game so that it does not... Their long-term vision does not cloud their vision in the matches. So I think they're taking it in the right manner, and with a lot of people going to come back from injury, Sanchez has just made an entry, And Welbeck is apparently back in training, and Wilshere will be here in a couple of months. So exciting times ahead for Gunners, and yeah, I think this could be the year.
Wow, that's a big statement made by Partey. He believes that this could be the year for Arsenal. That's huge, that's huge. And they have performed very well, if one must give it to them. I think the main thing, the main cog in the wheel for them has been Ozil's and his form. Finally, he stepped up to the plate and he's been doing consistently well. I think Wenger has always had a soft spot for Ozil, and finally he's repaying his fate. And do you believe that City, what are they doing? I mean, they have such a good squad on paper. They've got De Bruyne, they've got Sterling, they've got Aguero, one of the best strikers in the world. Why are they messing up so badly? What do you think is going wrong with them?
It's the extra pace which has been like pushed into the team suddenly. The people that you see, like a Yaya Toure or the other CDM, the Fernando or the and any other person whom they play. First mistake is there. The second is Vincent Kompany's injury, which troubled the defense. Like, Vincent Kompany was a leader behind. He wasn't there, and there's a very interesting stat. Like, somewhere in the 5 starting game, City just conceded 2 goals, and after that, they conceded the rest of them. Like, from that time to the time Vincent Kompany has not been there, which is around 10 games easily, if I'm not wrong, 10 games. Yeah. So in that period, they've conceded around 12, 15 or some 16 goals. I'm not sure about my stat, but that is how it has been affecting the team. And the sudden pace which has been pushed in by Sterling and Kevin De Bruyne. So the team is not probably used to it. Aguero has also been very out, so him also coming in, then they trying some different combination. So for a person like a Yaya Toure or a Fernando, or even for the sake of Sterling, who's pretty used to his position still here, but the support which he used to receive in Liverpool, because the team used to play around him. Here people are not playing around a particular player in a particular manner. They're always going for, say, like, if Aguero has to score a goal in this manner, they create the situation for Aguero in that way, and that's not happening. Rather, look for some other options who can score. And that pace, when they're trying to look for the option, they are missing out sometimes. I'm not saying that they're losing badly, but sometimes they are not able to score, and the other team scores one goal or maybe just one goal above them, and then Manchester City falls. But they're still there. I'm not saying they've gone anywhere.
Yeah, one must not forget the fact that even now they sit second in the table and are ahead of Arsenal as well. So we aren't discounting them. It's just that with the squad they have, we all believe that they could have done much better and they should have maybe even dominated the league. And so, guys, wrapping the football section up, let's just have your top four. Who do you believe will finish in the top four this year?
I think I'll go with Arsenal, City, Spurs and Leicester.
Some big calls there.
I cannot predict the winner, but I want this top four to be there. So Arsenal, City, Leicester and maybe Spurs.
Funny thing there, everybody discounting United. And I think it's when we're down that we really rise. So it's time for Van Gaal's army to rise from the ashes. Whether Van Gaal remains or not, we will see. But we will come back. And United will be a force this season. Now let's move on to cricket. India has been absolutely sensational in the two T20s so far. Even though we were thrashed in the ODIs in Australia. Although we did compete in all of them. But finally, there seems to be a hint of resurgence in the Indian team. Bumrah's inclusion in the team has also coincided with this rich vein in form. Do you guys believe? I'm very fond of Jasprit Bumrah's bowling, by the way. So do you guys believe that we are on the up and that we could be serious contenders for the World T20?
Yeah, I think this is the perfect time for someone like Jasprit Bumrah to come into the team, being mentored by a great like Ashish Nehra. So I think it's the perfect time for him to observe Nehra, see his run-ups, learn where to pitch the ball from him. And you know, it's great to when you have such a huge mentor around for a youngster like Bumrah. So I think it's going to do a great deal for his career. And yeah, if this partnership kicks on, then I think we could be strong contenders because our batting has always been our strength. It has always been the bowling that has let us down, barring the World Cup, which was a shock. But I think that if the bowling kicks in well, then I think we have a good chance of winning the World Cup.
Also, we have seen recently that India's top order has consistently performed well. If it's not Rohit, it's Shikhar. If it's not Shikhar, it's Virat. The three have been in great form. But the problem lies with the middle order of India, which is we've tried a lot of permutations and combinations, but we've not settled down on a regular middle order combination. So do you think Yuvraj and Raina perhaps coming back adds some solidarity and allows Dhoni to therefore be more free and play his shots? Or do you believe that we should stick with youngsters like Manish Pandey or, you know, Manoj Tiwari or maybe even Shreyas Iyer?
See, Manoj Tiwari is a like a person who has not grabbed the opportunity. Even if he has grabbed the opportunity, probably he retires hurt after the match, or maybe he's not able to show his fitness to that level that he's been kept there. Manish Pandey came in, he cashed in his opportunity. But right now,
do you believe Yuvraj and Raina offer solidarity and therefore they should stick with these guys, or do you believe that?
See, so that's what I'm saying. I'm picking out the best one out of the lot from the person who can fit into that number 5 position.
Okay.
And comparing him with a Yuvraj or a Raina. So considering the age factor, I wouldn't probably want a Yuvraj to be there. I would want Manish Pandey to be there because that is a position which has been troubling us for a very long time. It's not a position which has just come in as a problem ho rahi hai us pe. Raina stable hone ke pehle problem hoti thi. Aur Lakshman ke chhodne ke baad also there was a lot of problems. So that position has been kept very dicey always. Say like a Mohammad Kaif used to play in that. A 5-6-7 wale time pe. So it's a position in which you need solidarity, which even if a Yuvraj is giving you, which he has given over the years, but he'll not give you in the next till the next 5 years, 10 years when you're planning your future. You want a batsman who's solid there in his defense. And so you have to keep trying the new one rather than going back to the old ones. That's what how the selectors are thinking probably.
And we talk a lot about India's batting woes abroad and how we struggle when we go to away conditions, our bowlers struggle, we can't find the right lines and lengths. But we must remember that every single nation in the cricketing world right now is struggling away. It's not just us. We decimated South Africa at home. Then we've been decimated by Australia when we've gone there. So it seems to be a travelling bug which has bitten all the teams right now in the world. And what do you think, Pat? I mean, why is this happening?
I think people are too used to home conditions, too used to the pitches being made for their benefits. And they are very used to these tailor-made conditions that it's become tough for them to adapt to a new condition. And it's become very obvious now that pitches are made to benefit the home teams, as we saw in the Indian series with South Africa. So it has been an issue that has been kept creeping up all the time. And I think that's the exact reason why people are not playing well abroad.
Ajmer, do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, it's the more commercial aspect of the game that has got into this, which is why we as a team, we are bad travelers. I'm not saying as individual players, we are bad travelers. If you pick up the stats, you'll come to know there are certain players in every team who consistently perform in every country that they are going. Maybe say like a 50, 60 or a okay-ish average, but they're not the bad ones. They're not amongst the bad ones. So there are certain players who've adapted themselves into that style of going around and playing in different pitches. So these are the players who have majorly played in the IPL, majorly played in a Big Bash League, or else played in a like a Caribbean Premier League. All these things are giving them money. it's okay.
Yeah, but and also must not forget that England have recently defeated South Africa in South Africa. So it's not like every team struggles in every series. I mean, it's just going, it depends. And England is a good team right now. They're very consistent.
So that way with the part which he's saying that the pitches, we make pitches which are very flat and rank turners, it's because the other team players are so adapted to our situation. Say like a South African players, if you make a pitch which is fair, I'm so sure, like, even if it's a slight turner and not a rank turner, we might probably lose that match. Because those players are also pretty used to playing in Indian conditions. Similarly, the other players are also used to playing in a English condition when they're playing the county cricket. Those players are only coming up right now, right? All the budding cricketers are only coming up who have travelled every place. And these players also IPL and all that, because they travel kar rahe sare. So that is why if you're not making a pitch which is suiting exactly your condition, you might end up having a 50-50 or end up on the losing side also. T20 mein bhi, we've beaten Australia na. We are beating them straight three games in a row.
The pitches have also been good.
Huh. They've kept a fair pitch.
Yeah.
We weren't able to step up in a batting. That's why we lost in few of the ODIs. Otherwise, we would have killed them there also.
Patriotic words there from Vaibhav Ajmera. Now let us have the predictions to the four semi-finalists of the upcoming World T20 part.
I'll go second on this one.
India, Pakistan, South Africa, and Australia.
I think Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, and maybe India.
Okay, so you think Pakistan will not make it?
Yes.
Okay, those were some bold predictions there from our two guests. And now we finish this off with the other sports section. So today we're going to talk about the Australian Open and tennis. And Part, what do you feel about Djokovic's reach? I mean, can anyone even beat him? I mean, nobody's coming close.
Yeah, he looks lethal before every game. And so whenever you hear about Djokovic playing a game with either Federer or Nadal or Murray, you always get this feeling that he's going to end up on the winning side. So I think he's had the best of purple patches for a long time, I think. So I think, yes, he is turning out to be one of the best tennis players in his generation. But is he better than Nadal? Is he better than Federer? That only time will tell.
It's funny you said, is he better than Federer? You said, I'm sorry for Nadal, because I think it's pretty obvious now that he's become an overall better player than Nadal. He's performed better than Nadal. I mean, Nadal, in his times, he was amazing. He's beaten Federer in Wimbledon. He's won hardcore tournaments against Federer. Possibly, he has a better win-loss record against Federer than Federer does against him. But overall, if you look at the stats, Federer has completely dominated the generation. And now Djokovic is coming in and he's continuing in the same vein. And I think in the next generation, except for maybe Raonic now, I don't really see anybody coming up. But let us also talk about the Indian contingent in the Australian Open. Pace and Bhupati, nowhere to be seen, alright. But Inges and Mirza, I mean, you've got to give it to them. Their 12th mixed Grand Slam doubles medal, and I mean they did so well. And Hingis at her age, Mirza, I mean it's amazing, right? What do you guys feel?
Yeah, when I heard the news and the opposition or somebody from the Indian team only, I guess Leander Pace was there with some other.
Was the mixed doubles?
Mixed doubles. They also went to the finals, right?
Yeah, Sania Mirza's team beat Leander Pace.
But that's amazing there. I mean, that's an other piece of insight offered to us by our guests over here. And I feel like we have pretty much reached the end of this discussion. I don't think we have much to say. If you actually sat through the entire podcast, we thank you. From the bottom of our hearts, we thank you. I mean, it's been great. We did this for you. We love you. We will continue to do this. and we will continue to have the same fun. And next time, if you guys have any tips for what we can add to the podcast, you know, maybe a rapid fire round or whatever, just let us know in the comments. Let us know what you feel. And this is our signing off from the Sports Podcast. But music, please.